Well, folks, let's unite our hearts together and pray. We come before the throne of grace with confidence in and through Jesus, our Saviour. Lord God, we give thanks that as we gather together today, that we do so as those who come to worship a God who is alive, one who is alive and who reigns, one who is seated upon his throne, one who is sovereign, one who is holy and who is righteous, the one in whom there is no crookedness at all, one in whom we find equity and justice, the one who exudes love, the one who has exercised mercy and grace to us as a wayward people in and through the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour, the one whose blood has been shed in order that we might be the children of God, in order that we may be reconciled unto you by his blood, that we may be forgiven of our sin, that we may be adopted into your family as sons and daughters. And so we rejoice this morning, Lord God, in your gracious provision to us of the Lord Jesus, the light of the world, the one who has come to dispel the darkness, the one who is the true light that shines. And Lord, we pray that this morning you would illuminate the hearts and the minds of those who are still in spiritual darkness, those who have not yet come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that even by your word this morning, that your spirit would act in power to bring life, eternal life, abundant life, full life to those who do not yet know that. Lord God, we thank you for the great provision and promises that we have through your word and scripture to live our lives according to. And we pray that as those of us who profess your name and who claim you as our own, That we would use your word to our advantage and to our benefit, that we would live in light of it and according to it, that we would refer to it, that we would root ourselves in it, that we would be shaped by it, and that through your Spirit we would be effective witnesses, ambassadors here where you have placed us for the glory of your name and for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Lord, at this time we remember those in the world who are suffering, those who are struggling, those who are faced with insurmountable challenge within their lives. And we pray, God, that you would act for them, on their behalf, in them, through them, that you would be around them, that you would sustain them, and that you would keep them, and that you would bless them. We think especially of the peoples of Ukraine. We pray that you would continue to thwart the effort of the enemy, that you would continue to drive Russian forces out. We pray for peace in that land. We pray for those who have been traumatized by war, those who have been bereft of loved ones through the mindlessness of invasion. And Lord, we pray that even in the darkness and even in the rubble of that country, that you would bring healing, that you would bring hope, and that you would bring peace, the peace that passes understanding, the peace that is born of God and of God alone. We remember our own leadership in our own nations. Lord God, we pray for integrity and diligence, conscientiousness, honesty and transparency in the halls of power. We pray that you would raise up people of honor, people of integrity to lead our nation, and that you would install within the halls of power those who know you, those who adhere to your word and to your precepts, and that they would lead distinctly and differently from the homogenized thinking of the world where everybody is going with the flow. We know that only dead fish go with the flow. And so we pray, Lord God, for those to be in leadership who are willing to stand against the current and prevailing conditions in the world. We remember our Queen and her Platinum Jubilee year. We thank you for her. We thank you for the celebrations that will come. But most of all, Lord God, we thank you for the faith that she possesses so evidently and which she has witnessed to consistently down through the years. We pray that that would be blessed to her, that it would be blessed to those around her, and it would be blessed to us as a nation, that as she speaks of Jesus, that many people would inquire more of you, and as they come to the light, that you would illuminate hearts and minds. So, Father, we pray that you would bless us in our worship today. May you illuminate our hearts and our minds, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to read this morning from John's Gospel in chapter 1. As already alluded to, we've recently begun a new study in John's Gospel under the theme of Believe. We looked at one of the last verses in John's Gospel to give us his motive for why he'd written this book. And he'd written these things accounted for in his Gospel that we may believe, and that in believing in him, in Jesus, we might have life. So we continue with our study this morning, reading from John 1. I'm reading the first 13 verses and really focusing today on the latter half of our reading, verses 6 to 13. This is God's Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. Amen. May the Lord bless that reading of his word to us. Let's just unite our hearts together again and pray. Father, we thank you that you are the one in whom we find light and the one in whom we find life. You are the one who is the giver of life, the creator of life, the sustainer of life. And so, Lord, we pray that we would know you. We pray that we would know you for ourselves individually. We pray that we would know you corporately, as a congregation of your people, the body of Christ here in this place, that we would know you, your presence and your power and your spirit with us, sustaining us and keeping us. Lord God, we give thanks that your word is so clear. It is for us and for our good. It is living and it is active. And we pray that that would be the case yet this morning as we gather around it and as we consider it. Those of us who have been on the Christian road of belief, faith and trust for many years, and those perhaps who are starting out on that journey, and indeed those who are far from it, those who are still on the broad road that leads to destruction. Or we pray that each and every one would come to know the living Saviour, the light of the world, Jesus, the one who has come to give us life, who has not come to condemn the world, but to save the world. We give thanks for him. Father, remember those at this time who are struggling, those who are weak in body, those who are fragile in mind, those who are known to us and those who are unknown to us, those who have received devastating diagnosis even this week, and those known to people in the congregation, those who are faced with the unimaginable. Lord, we pray that in that you would strengthen your people to be a witness, to be a comfort, to be a strength and a support to those who are suffering and those who are struggling, and that you would come alongside them and that you would keep them. Lord, we pray for a passion and a zeal to be amongst your people here, that as we gather as the body of Christ in this place, that you would instill within us a great yearning for the things of God, that you would give to us a hunger after righteousness, a thirst after it, that we would be those who would be willing to serve, who would be willing to give our all for you as you have given for us. We would recognize that every good and perfect gift that is ours comes from above, and therefore that you would give us a generosity of heart in returning unto you thanks, physically, spiritually, emotionally, prayerfully, practically, financially, that we would be willing to be sacrificial with that that you have given us for the glory of your name, to serve your kingdom, perhaps not in great and flashy ways, perhaps in the mundane and in the ordinary and behind the scenes where nobody but you sees. Lord, that you would give us that servant heart that Christ had, that we would recognize that as he came to serve and not to be served, that we too would have that same great desire within our own hearts to serve and not to be served, that we would come here as those who are willing volunteers, willing servants in submission to God the Father, not spectators, not witnesses who come to watch and to observe others, but that we would be willing to engage and to work with and to get on our knees in prayer before you. You would give us a prayerful spirit and desire to see your kingdom flourish and those whom we know and those whom we love come to you in faith and in trust. And so, Lord, we pray that you would bless your word afresh to us this morning, that it would be a balm to our soul, that it would encourage us and would sustain us in all that lies ahead in the coming week. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Lord's my Savior and my light, who will make me dismayed. The Lord's the stronghold of my life. Why should I be afraid when evildoers threaten? All an army has.
don't know if any of you have been playing the latest craze online, which is called Wordle, where you get various letters of a word, or you have to work out what the word is from however many letters you get right or wrong. There's a new one out called Hurdle. So it's not just Wordle, there's also Hurdle. And in Hurdle, you get 1 second of a song, and you have to try and guess what that song or piece of music may be. So let's play a wee bit of Hurdle this morning. If I were to sing, "Here comes the sun, da 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 da," you would all know that that was... Oh, I can't be very good. The Beatles. They can't believe that nobody knows the Beatles. "Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun. And I say, it's all right." I think the Beatles make a good point. We are so reliant upon the sun. The sun is absolutely essential to life on Earth. The sun and its rays maintain our planet, though it is 93 million miles away from the Earth, it provides us with everything that we need. One writer said, "Sunlight is the fuel of life. Its energy maintains everything upon the Earth. From photosynthesis of the plant life to the vitamin D that we so crave, and especially as people in Westeros, we so crave that vitamin D that can so often be lacking within our system. But the sun even acts in reflecting and refracting light that enables us to perceive and to see things. Its gravitational pull keeps things in order. It keeps us tethered into our orbit as a planet. But those of us who know anything about the peculiarities of the English language recognize that sun can be spelt in two different ways. It can be spelt S-U-N, and it can be spelt S-O-N. And that's really what we come to today. The sun, S-U-N, sunlight, is needed for our physical well-being, to maintain and sustain life on planet Earth. It's needed for bios. Remember the three words that we spoke about in relation to life that are used in the Greek language, not just one word, but three words that are used in different contexts. Bios, relating to biological life, physical life, psyche, which pertains to cognitive life, and zoe, that word that pertains to life everlasting, eternal life. So sunlight, S-U-N, light, pertains really to the bios, to biological life. It is necessary for that. But the sunlight, S-O-N, light, that John talks about here, the Son of God, who was the true light coming into the world, is absolutely required for Zoe, for eternal life. And that's really the theme of John's continuous introduction here. He's still introducing us to Jesus. He's still presenting him, not just as the Word, the Logos, but also as the light of the world, as the sunlight, saying, step in to the sunlight, be illuminated in body, in mind, and in spirit, and live, know true life in and through the living Word, the Logos, the light of the world. Let's look at that then. I haven't got this up on the screen, but if you go back a couple of verses, if you've got your Bible, it says, "In him," we looked at this last time briefly, "in him," in Jesus, "was life. And the life, that life was the light of men." That's the first time that this theme of light is used. "And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness to bear light, to bear witness to the light, that through him all might believe." So John has begun with this introduction to who Jesus is. These opening 18 verses, you could say, are really the entire theme of the gospel. It's a briefing, if you will, to who Jesus is. We have to know who we're dealing with before we can truly begin to understand who he is. So that's what John does. He gives us an introduction to who Jesus is. He was the Word. He was with God. He was God. He created everything. He existed. He was pre-existent. He existed before time began. He is the source of light. He is the source of life. And if you will believe in him, you will know light and you will know life. And what we have here in the chapter and in these verses 6 to 13 are three things. We have a representative of the light, we have the light rejected, and we have the light received. So firstly, we have the light represented. The light is represented through John the Baptist. That's who John, the writer of the gospel here, the apostle, introduces us to. After he's introduced Jesus, he introduces John the Baptist. He's a representative of the light. He himself wasn't the light, but he was an agent, if you will, for the light. I used to be an estate agent. And before you boo and hiss at that, we weren't all bad. But as an estate agent, I was an agent of a company. So General Accident Property Services is what it was way back in the mists of the 90s, before it became Your Move. I wasn't Your Move. I wasn't General Accident. I was a representative of that company. I would go to potential clients' homes and tell them what their house was worth and how they should market it and what we could offer them. I was a representative of that company. And so it is here, John is a representative of Jesus. He's a witness to the light. And what John is at pains, the Apostle John is at pains here to illustrate to us, is that there are basically two responses to Jesus. One, you reject him. Two, you accept him. It's a very simple thing. There are two responses. You're either for or you're against. Those who are with me are with me. Those who are not with me scatter, says Jesus. So the question that we have to answer for ourselves to reconcile in our own minds this afternoon is, are we living in the sunlight? Or are we living in the shadowlands, spiritually speaking? Are we walking in the light of Christ? Or are we scrabbling around in the darkness? Verse 6 through 8 shows us how the light was represented by John. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Now from verse 6 we've got an abrupt change here, haven't we? Because up until this point, John has been dealing with everything divine. He's been dealing with the deity of Jesus, the Word, the living Word, the pre-existent Word, the one who was with and who also was God, the one who was the source of life, the one who was the creator and sustainer of life, the light of the world. But then immediately or abruptly, it changes to say there was a man. So he's not then dealing with Jesus anymore, the Logos, the Word. He's talking about a man, and he's not talking about himself, but about John the Baptist. So just to add a wee bit of confusion in here, we've got two Johns that we're thinking about here. Interestingly, John the Apostle, the writer, the author of this book, doesn't mention himself by name anywhere. He doesn't say, oh, by the way, I, John, I'm the writer here. I'm the guy, I, John, I was a disciple of Jesus. I was with Jesus. He doesn't call himself by name, but this is how he refers to himself. One time in the book, he says, I was the disciple whom Jesus loved. You might think, well, okay, don't mention yourself by name, but surely it's a bit arrogant to say that I am the one, the disciple that Jesus loved. I'm the disciple who Jesus loved. You say, no, well, it's not arrogant. He's just stating fact. He's saying, look, I am one of the people that Jesus loved as well. I'm just one of those who was loved by Jesus. But here he's talking about somebody specific. He's talking about not himself, but I'm talking about John the Baptist. And this is what he's got to say about John the Baptist. There was a man sent from God. If ever there was a man who was sent from God, it was John the Baptist. Predicted twice in the Old Testament. First in Isaiah 40, where he's called a voice of one calling, in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. John the Baptist will apply that text to himself later in this chapter. We'll get there. Also in the Old Testament, it closes with the prediction of an Elijah-like figure, a forerunner, if you will, who would come and who would testify to the imminent arrival of Jesus, the Messiah. Malachi 3:1, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. So here we have that guy, John the Baptist, the man sent by God. If we've got any doubts about that, we only have to open up Luke's gospel and have the story about Elizabeth and Zechariah, John the Baptist's parents. Remember, Elizabeth was barren, they couldn't have children. Zechariah is busy working away in the temple doing his priestly duty, and an angel appears and he's afraid. But the angel says, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many people of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." So this is the John that the Apostle John is referring to here in the opening verses of his gospel. He's referring to John the Baptist, the one who was foretold, the one who was promised, and the one who came to fulfill all that had gone before. John the Baptist wasn't just any man. He was the greatest, until Christ, John the Baptist was the greatest person who had ever lived. You say, well, with what warrant do you make that assumption? Well, Matthew 11, it wasn't me that said it, it was Jesus. "Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist." That is quite a statement. "Yet whoever is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." A great promise for the Christian in Christ. "But among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than he." Quite a statement. Greater than Abraham? Yes, greater than Abraham. Moses? Yes, greater than Moses. David, Isaiah, Noah, Jeremiah? Why? Why was he greater than all of these great figures of the faith? Well, I think simply because he performed a great task, announcing for the first time, publicly introducing, if you will, Jesus Christ, Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. We'll read about that more as we go on. So for God to do the most important task, the greatest task of all, he gets the greatest man up until that point who had ever lived. And what was this mission? Well, here we have it in verse 7. "He came as a witness to testify concerning that light so that through him all might believe." We already began our study by looking at the penultimate chapter of John's gospel in John chapter 20 and verse 13. We saw that John's motive to write all of these things that are included in his gospel were done so with the express desire and purpose that we might believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that by believing in him, we might have life. So the two Johns are on the same page. They have the same desire. John the Baptist, that is why he's here. He is fulfilling his life's ambition, the goal for which he was set apart, to usher in the Son, who is the light of the world. More than that, John the Baptist was a witness. A technical term, a courtroom term, if you will. We've seen a lot of courtroom drama over the past few weeks, if you've been keeping an eye on the news headlines. Johnny Depp and Amber Heard, back and forth, a bit of a circus. But they've been calling many different witnesses. And why did they call a witness? To find out what they saw, when they saw it, how they heard things, what was apparent to them, for their eyewitness testimony. And it's like the Apostle John gathers together humanity and thus says today, look, I've got a message for you, folks. I want to tell you, Jesus is the Messiah. He's God in human flesh. He's the creator of all things that exist. He's the source of light and life. And in order to prove that to you, I want to call my first witness to the stand, and his name's John the Baptist. And he'll tell you. He'll tell you what he saw, because he saw Jesus, and he was with Jesus, and he pointed people to Jesus. And so John the Baptist is the Apostle John's first witness, coming to bear witness to the reality and the veracity of the gospel message and the person of Jesus. And you can watch out for that term, because throughout John's gospel, this is the first of eight witnesses that there are that John calls on through his gospel, calling them to the stand to make sure that Jesus is presented fairly. So the whole purpose of John the Baptist's life was to bear witness to the light. And when he uses the term light to refer to Jesus, he's using it in a metaphorical sense. He doesn't mean that Jesus was like the ready bread kid, you know, walking around with a bit of a glow around about him all the time. It doesn't mean that because Jesus was there, he had a halo and he lit up the room. It didn't mean that because Jesus was around, you didn't need a candle or a lamp in your room. That's not the picture. The picture here is metaphorical, because the Bible uses a number of things, uses the term light to speak of a number of things. Firstly, it speaks of the glory of God. Often the light, the word light, is employed to speak physically of the glory of God. Think about right back to the beginning. We went back to the beginning last week as we considered the pre-existence of Jesus. But think now back to the first words of the Creator when the world was founded. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. David, the psalmist, as he looked up to the lights in the sky, to the heavens, he said, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim his handiwork. When we look at the night sky just now, atle de buoy, little light pollution. You look up in a clear light and you clear night and you see the majesty of the skies, the Milky Way and all of the different star patterns and formations. In the book of Revelation, it tells us that in the New Jerusalem, there will be no sun and no moon because God's glory will illuminate it. So physically speaking, light speaks of the glory of God. And therefore, for John to say that Jesus is the light is to say that he embodies the glory of God in human form. Hebrews 1:3, the author says, the sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Another powerful verse for our Jehovah's Witness friends who come and deny the deity of Jesus. The sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. But not only does light like or ascribed to the glory of God, but also to the knowledge of God. Intellectually, light speaks of the knowledge of God, the illuminating nature of God. God is known, the technical term is omniscient, all-knowing, sovereign. He's the ultimate knower. He doesn't need to be told. He doesn't need to learn. He just knows. There was a time in history called the Dark Ages, where it said that people lived without the light of knowledge. And then came the next age, the Age of Enlightenment, when suddenly there was a renaissance of learning and knowledge and art. God is the ultimate knower. He's the ultimate know-it-all. He knew what people thought. He knew what their motives were. He knows our hearts. He knows our motives. Yet today, he was ultimately enlightened. He knew when he would be betrayed, who he would be betrayed by, when he would die, where he would go, when he's coming again. So the glory of God, the knowledge of God, thirdly, the holiness of God. Morally, light speaks of God's holiness. It speaks of a pureness and a brilliance. And to say that God is light or that Jesus is light speaks of their purity, the holiness. 1 Timothy 6, Paul writes, God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light. Another way to put it is that there is no flaw in the character of God, that he is perfect. There's no indiscretion. There is no flaw. And therefore, to say that Jesus is light is to say that he is pure and holy and perfect, and in him there is no flaw. In fact, later on in this gospel, he'll ask the religious leaders this very penetrating question. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? The answer, no, no one, because there was no sin in him. He was pure and he was righteous and he was holy. Now, in all of that, the glory of God, the knowledge of God, the holiness of God, embodied in this term light, what does it mean? It means that if Jesus Christ is light, it means that if we follow him, we are in the light. That we take a step out of darkness. So if I say I'm a Christian believer, I'm a disciple of Christ, I'm a follower of Jesus, it means I have stepped out of moral darkness into the holy light of Jesus. Doesn't mean I'm perfect. Doesn't mean I've made it. Doesn't mean I'll never make a mistake, because I'm not perfect and I will make mistakes. But what it means is I am following the one in whom the true light is found. I'm growing. I'm being sanctified, made more like him. John was a man, it says here, sent from God. Is that not what we should all desire to be? Is that not the greatest aspiration that we could have as the Lord's people? Just a person sent by God as a witness to his light. Verse 7, he came as a witness to testify concerning that light so that through him all might believe. Through who? Through John the Baptist, not through Jesus. It's in the translation here, you might think reading it, he came as a witness to testify concerning the light so that through him, through Jesus, all might believe. But it's not that. It's so that through him, through John the Baptist, in other words, John is the conduit. He is the channel, if you will. He's the gate by which people see a vision of Christ, that he is the one who is pointing people to Jesus in order that they may believe. So here's a question for you this afternoon. Is your life a gate or is it a wall? You know, posties go through innumerable gates every day. They're probably a bit of a hassle. But gates lead to different places. As we look through somebody's gate, we get a snapshot of their life, their home, where they live. And for the Christian, as people look at us, we should be a gate into the glory, the joy of God. We should be a gate into the truth of Jesus. We should be a gateway toward light. Or are we a wall? Uniform, indistinct, ordinary. The same as our agnostic neighbor on one side and our atheist neighbor on the other. Do people look at us and see no difference, keeping up with the Joneses? Or do our lives, in our lives, do we point to the Savior in how we live, in how we witness, in what we do? Surely the highest goal that each and every one of us can have is the same as John the Baptist, that we have come, that we have been sent from God to bear witness to the light. So the light is represented by John. Secondly, in this passage, we see the light rejected. Verse 9. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. The light is rejected. You could argue that Jesus' whole life is summed up in these couple of verses. His life was a life of rejection. He came to a world that he had created, to a people whom he had created, to those whom he loved, and they didn't want to know. No thanks. No thanks, Jesus. Not for me. Not really interested. Don't want anything to do with it. So he is rejected by the very people that he has come to save. He came into the world, but they did not recognize him. The Greek word here is gnosko, and it has that idea of recognition. You know, regardless of maybe how long it's been since you've seen somebody that you know, as soon as you see them, even in a crowded arrivals lounge or on a crowded bus station or on a train platform, as soon as a face steps off, you can recognize them even from a distance. There's that element here, this idea of recognition. The Creator God, the Messiah, has come in human form, but his people do not recognize him. They don't connect the dots. That hasn't changed. In the world in which we live, one thing that the world at large, generally speaking, consistently gets wrong is the identity of Christ, the identity of Jesus, who Jesus was. Oh, well, he was a good man. He was a prophet. He was this, he was that. It's not new. In the four Gospels, there are individuals or people and scenarios spoken of where people misunderstand or misconstrue or misrepresent who Jesus is. I don't have these on slides, Andrew, so you don't need to worry. John chapter 7, some said that he was a good man, whilst others said that he was a deceiver. What does the survey say? Wrong. Matthew 16. Some said he was John the Baptist, others said Elijah, some said Jeremiah, others said one of the prophets. And the survey says? No. John 6, after he feeds the 5,000, the 25,000, they wanted to take him by force and make him king. They didn't realize who he was. In Luke 23, he's called a tax evader. Imagine Jesus up against the HMRC. Wouldn't mind seeing that. He's subverting the government, they're saying. John 10, they say, oh, he's got a demon. Even Mark 3, his own family get the answer wrong, don't they? They go to Capernaum, his mother and his brothers, to take him away because he's out of his mind. And the survey says, nothing's changed. Still, people get who Jesus is wrong. He was a magician who practiced illusions. He was a zealot, a guru, a world traveler. He was the husband of Mary Magdalene. Jesus was probably just an illiterate form of low caste, an illiterate from a low caste of artisans. Jesus' resurrection was a cloning performed by aliens who made humans in a laboratory DNA experiment 25,000 years ago. What do we say to all these things? Wrong. If there's something or someone that the world consistently gets wrong, consistently even, it's Jesus. He was in the world. And though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. But then John gets more specific. He says in verse 11, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. So he's saying, look, okay, generally you put Jesus in the world and generally the world doesn't receive him. But then specifically his own people, the Jewish nation, didn't receive him, didn't recognize him, didn't accept him. That's what he's saying. He came to his own. There are two owns used in that verse. The first own in that sentence is in the neuter gender, and it refers to things like place, land, home. It's general in that sense. But the second own that's in that sense is masculine in gender, and it refers to a people. So it could be literally translated, he came to his own place or nation, but his own people did not receive him. That's why the New Living Translation puts it this way. He came to his own people and even they rejected him. You know, that in the Jewish Talmud, the central text of the rabbinic Judaism, you know what they say that Jesus, who Jesus was? This is a quote. He was the illegitimate son of Mary. That's who he was in the Jewish rabbinic tradition. The illegitimate son of Mary, who was a hairdresser, apparently. How they got that, I'm not quite sure. But you see what John's saying here. He's saying, look, here's Jesus, the creator, the word, the sustainer, the life, the light, who's come into the world, come to his nation, come to his place, come to his city, come into his temple. And his people have rejected him. They have not received him. Even though for centuries, the Jews had been waiting for the Messiah, the predicted one. Even though Jesus was fulfilling that word, still they rejected him to the point that they said, crucify him. His blood be on us and our children. That was their response to the light. They They hated him. He was too bright for them. The very hands that had created them were the same hands that they nailed to the cross. He came to his own, but his own did not receive him. That's the position of the world. And we see it over and over again in our own lives, and we will see it over and over again as we look at the Gospel of John. Have you accepted or are you rejecting Jesus, the light? The light was represented by John. The light was rejected by most, but thirdly, the light was received. There is good news. Verse 12, but to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. John obviously didn't go to the same English teacher as I did, because you never start a sentence with but, and you never start a sentence with because. And yet, because, this little conjunction, this negative conjunction that he uses here, is used. It's this massive hinge. It's a small word with massive implications. But we did that study recently on a Wednesday evening. But God changes everything. This whole thing shifts in a different direction now. People rejected him. Jesus came and showed himself, and people turned away and people rejected. But yet, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Notice how he goes from the very wide, broad, to the very narrow and specific, doesn't he? He goes from the general population to the individual person. He speaks, first of all, about the world. The world did not recognize him. And then it talks about he came to his own people, the Jewish people, and they didn't receive him. But now to the individual, yet to all who did receive him. In other words, to anyone. Any individual. So it goes from the wide right down to the narrow. The world didn't want him. His own people didn't want him. Do you want him? Do you want him? As many as received him, he gave the power, he gave the right to become children of God. The world did not want him. His people did not want him. But do you want him? Because if you want him, you have to receive him. We have to receive him. Because to receive him is to believe in him. Receive and believe are synonyms of one another. To receive Christ is to believe in Christ. And it's more than just intellectual. The idea here is not just to say, yes, I believe that Jesus was the Son of God. The idea is to receive him, to make it personal, to experience it, to surrender ourselves to him wholly and fully in our lives. And there's something here that we should note that's obvious and that we've spoken of before, but that we have to pick up on. We are not born children of God. The world says, oh, well, you know, we're all children of God. No, we're not. Not according to the Bible. You go to a funeral and say, well, you know, regardless of how this person lived and regardless of what they did, they're in heaven now because everybody goes to heaven. Not according to the Bible. Not according to the Word of God. As many as received him, he gave them the right to become children of God. We're not born as Christians. We are born again as Christians. We are given new life, a new heart, a new hope, made a new creation in Christ as we step into the light and as we receive the light into our hearts and our lives. We are a child of God, not by creation, but by redemption. As we receive Christ, we receive the right, the power to become God's children. And he goes on and emphasizes it in verse 13, doesn't he? Children born not of natural descent, not of human decision or a husband will, but born of God. It doesn't come by bloodline or heritage. It doesn't come because your grandmother was a faithful Christian or because your uncle was an elder or because you've attended church or you've gone here, come here now and again. Not because you were born into a Christian family. To become a child of God, we must be born again. Born from above. We must be born again by receiving and believing in Jesus, the Logos, the Word. There are two possible responses to the light. The sunlight shines, and one response is the majority response, rejection. That's the wrong response. The The second response is a minority response, and it is the right response. 1 John 5 says, "We know that we are children of God, and that the whole world is under the control of the evil one." The world, et al., by and large, is wrong about Jesus. We are in the minority. But we're with Jesus, who said in Matthew 7, "Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." The light has come. John came as a representative of the light. Most of the world rejects him. Some will receive him. I wonder where you fall into in that category today. Are you still in the darkness and the futility of your own minds? Or will you step into the sunlight today? All I've done is give a message. I can't save anyone. I can just point to the light, Jesus, the true light, the one who, if you will receive and if you will believe, he will save, and he will enlighten, and he will make clear your way, and he will adopt you as his children. So perhaps if we change the spelling of the Beatles song, the spelling of that word sun, rather than "here comes the sun in the sky," what about "here comes the S-O-N," "here comes the sun, here comes the sun," and I say, it's all right. Everything will be all right if we are in the sunlight. Let's pray. Our God and Father, we give thanks for your word. We give thanks for its power. We give thanks for its truth. We give thanks for its light. We pray that we would be recipients of, who graciously receive the light of the world, and that you would change our hearts and give us great hope for the future. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, we conclude by singing from the hymn, "And Can It Be?" And that second verse there talks about the dungeon of our minds being flamed with light as Jesus comes in and liberates us from the shackles of sin and death and the freedom that comes with faith in him. Shall we stand and sing together, "And Can It Be?"
Jesus and all in him is
And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with us all now and evermore. All God's people say, Amen.